There's a lot of talk about this movie at the festival, a lot of word of mouth, and I have to begin with a question that's been going around that I've heard a lot. When you started work on this movie, you had, and I'm talking to you, John.
Oh.
You had a lot in common with me, with a lot of people, although I dare say not all, in the audience, which is that you had never made a movie before.
True that.
And I wonder if you could begin just by breaking the tension here and telling us about your don't know what the fuck you're doing movie directing technique.
Thank you.
Because we would all like to know how you started not knowing anything at all and produced what I think everybody would agree is a superbly self-assured, beautiful, profound movie. And I'd like to go from there and ask about the don't know what the fuck you're doing movie technique from Maziar and also Gael as well.
Well, I was fortunate that Gael knew what the fuck he was doing. You know, having done the show for many years, there was obviously an enormous difference to try and translate something into narrative. So first things first, I had Maziar's book, which is, if any of you have had a chance to get it, it's utterly compelling. It's incredibly well observed. It has the ability to be a part of a very uncomfortable story and all the things that he went through, yet still with a journalist's eye for detail and absurdity, and obviously his ability to maintain a sense of humor throughout.
It's called Then They Came For Me.
Then They Came For Me, and it is available. Yeah, okay.
From your local bookseller.
Yeah, I was gonna try and pitch it.
Go ahead.
So the source material is there. You know, all you have when you're trying to translate something is your intention. And doing the show for 16 years is an exercise in intention, but just sped up. So in other words, I would have some stupid idea at 6 o'clock in the morning that wakes me up about what it's like to talk about the Israel-Gaza situation. And by 6 o'clock p.m. that night, I would understand how to translate that intention to the form that we work in. I know what the render times are. I know what it would take graphically. I know what it takes in terms of the montages. If we want to make changes, I know exactly what it takes. The issue with the film wasn't about not understanding intention or not understanding narrative, but translating that to a completely different form where if I had an idea, I didn't understand how that, you know, you don't want to be the guy to walk into a scene in the morning and go, what if we took, I don't know, what if we made it 500 people? And then everybody just goes, I can't fucking believe this. So the biggest challenge at first, and in the way of assembling a team, I had Bobby Bukowski, who is a very experienced DP and a wonderful guy. I had Jerry Sullivan as a production designer. We sat for a long time together, and I just talked intention with them. My intention of what this should look like, what it should feel like, and we talked about how to take my vocabulary and put it into their vernacular. And that, so it wasn't so much a question of, I leaned on everyone else's experience, people who knew what they were doing, and they were able to help me translate the intention, because that's something that's universal throughout any sort of content.
And this entire time you were working on the adaptation?
No, this was afterwards. Are you talking about, yeah, the adaptation was earlier. Mm-hmm. That was, the screenplay was earlier.
Could you talk a little bit about doing that, about putting this together?
About the screenplay?
Yeah.
Are you familiar with amphetamines? No, that's not it. You know, that was, again, it was, I had a source material and I had a source, and Maziar and I just discussed a lot about, you know, there were certain themes that I felt were important to weave through, and I tried to do it in sort of a triplet fashion. There were certain narrative choices. Making the choice not to leave the prison once Maziar is arrested. You know, I think a more standard narrative form would be, you go to the prison, and then you cut back to the people working on his behalf, then back to the prison. I did not want the audience to be able to experience any relief. Because one of the most important things about what Maziar went through, and maybe we'll get to talk about it later, is that it's not torture in a cinematic way. I think we've all become accustomed to viewing abuse in Hollywood terms. A large man standing over you, yelling, burning, punching, tell us what you know. Regimes around the world have bureaucratized torture. And they've done it in a way that is not cinematic, but in many ways banal. And I think it was important for people to understand that the nature of his discomfort was in the inability to control where you were at any time and to be just removed. You know, and we do that here in the United States. We have people in solitary confinement. That's torture. And so I wanted to make sure that this movie was not torture porn, that it was not a lurid cinematic version of what that meant, but the reality of what journalists and activists and people are going through, you know, around the world. So that was the narrative decision there, and that informed the structure of the screenplay.
It should be added that the United States is one of those nations that bureaucratized torture, and that those people who committed it have never been punished as we sit here.
But they are painting beautiful pictures of cats.
This is true. You can find them on the internet. Maziar, can you talk about that distinction between physical pressure, to use the euphemism for beating, essentially, and torture, psychological torture? Can you talk about a little bit what you found, whether you were surprised by...
Yeah, sure. I mean, one of the things that John and I talked about early on was the subtext of the story and what is going to be shown in the film, what's going to end up in the script, and then will be shown in the film. And I remember Norman Jewison once said that never show the subtext. So John and I, we discussed torture a lot. And, you know, I had done stories, many stories about torture in Iraq, in Afghanistan, in Iraq during the time of Saddam Hussein, then in Abu Ghraib and all that. And what people have to understand about the Iranian government is that the Iranian government has been in power for 35 years. Many of the people in the Iranian government, they were tortured before the revolution, during the time of the Shah. They were physically and brutally tortured. And when you talk about torture in the 70s, it is something that the Israelis and the Americans did not invent. It was basically invented by the British, the modern torture techniques in Northern Ireland. And then, of course, the Israelis used that technique. They showed it, they taught the Shah's regime and the Americans, you know, the collaboration with the Israelis and the Iranian partners before the revolution, they made it into a modern physical torture techniques. But many of the people within the Iranian government who became torturers after becoming tortured, they told me that when you physically torture someone, there is a threshold of tolerance that the torturer does not know where it is, because it's very specific for different individuals. So, and after you cross that threshold of tolerance, instead of undermining the ability of that person to defend himself or herself and divulge information about whatever the torturer wants, it empowers that person. So the person reaches some sort of nirvana. They think that they have an extra power because of that physical torture. So what the Iranian government and many governments around the world, including the governments that I mentioned earlier, they're doing these days is that they are trying to use psychological torture. So the food is good usually in these prisons, like in many prisons. I always say that, you know, in Evin prison in Tehran, the food was much better than most airlines. I know it doesn't say much, but it was much better. But so they keep you physically strong. They don't put physical pressure on you. But then they deprive you of your freedom. They put you in solitary confinement. They intimidate your family. They ask you stupid questions. And my interrogator, of course, asked me a lot of questions, but stupid questions. But maybe those, I sometimes think that he cannot be that stupid. Maybe he's asking me to those stupid questions in order to, you know, just confuse me, just to, you know, bore me with, you know, boredom can be kind of a torture, because when you're, the first thing that you, I mean, torture is really banal. When you walk into a solitary confinement, you don't think about your family, you don't think about your colleagues or, you know, your profession. The first thing you think about is that, how can I go to the toilet? You know, because when they put you in a solitary confinement, you cannot go to the toilet if there is not toilet in it. And most solitary confinements, they don't have toilet. So in Iran, which is a Shia country, unlike the Sunni countries that they pray five times a day, they do three times a day. So we could go out of the solitary confinement only three times a day in order to go to the toilet. So making the very long story short is that this psychological torture, it is much more effective. It has been proved for the, and these people, they studied. I mean, I know that my torturer, my interrogator, knew about the American torture techniques. Because, you know, in America, you have handbook of enhanced interrogation, interrogation handbooks, and they know all about that. They translate it into Persian, so they know what methods the Americans use. And they have gone through that experience, so they know exactly what is going on. And it's just like depriving a person of his or her freedom is a torture. And I think John has done a great job by not going Zero Dark 30 in this film. And, you know, because those kind of tortures, like what we see on television now with ISIS, beheading, and, you know, pulling nails, these are anomalies these days. These are not methodical, institutionalized torture that is happening all around the world. What you see in Rosewater is what is happening in many, many countries, unfortunately, around the world.
It's fascinating and profoundly sad that you do have now an international body of knowledge of torture, and that the techniques are traded among countries. Those who are interested here in the British techniques that Maziar mentioned can simply Google the five techniques for some hair-raising stories of what went on in Northern Ireland in the late 1970s. And indeed, other intelligence units have learned a great deal from this, and you see them cropping up in what the United States did, what the Iranians do, and so on. And it's rather fascinating seeing how this, and sad, seeing how these are traded back and forth. I want to ask Gael about representing the kind of physical and spiritual anguish which is really the result of the torture in the second half of this movie, how you prepared for that and what it was like.
Well, everything came from the book. Just like everything. No, but from this, from Maziar's book, I mean, there is a lot of detail there let alone the practical and specific things that were done to him, and that he knew that was done to other prisoners, but also like of the description of the psychological description of despair, and there is a moment in the book when Maziar mentions that he started to talk to himself and talk to his parents and talk to his sister, and they started to appear in prison with him, to accompany him, and I mean, it's very clear when he says that was something that kept you going, right? I mean, that kept you thinking, that there was, I mean it was like a reflective a place where he would kind of bounce back and forth his ideas of how the hell am I gonna make it? Am I gonna get out of here? How am I gonna survive this? Is this it as well? You know, coming to terms also with the fact that maybe that's it. Like it's not gonna get any better than this. And so just from his experience, and obviously translating it and putting it into our body. I mean, because at that point you enter another realm of you know, of common understanding, where what would I feel in that situation, in a way? I mean, what would I experience? And it is just horrendous. I mean, it's just, it is one I mean, you get glimpses, being an actor, you get glimpses of this kind of things that hopefully you will never be put through, but with emotional empathy, which is the closest thing you can do, because you cannot really identify, you cannot really understand, because that takes, I mean, we're in such a distance from that, but the only thing I could do was emotional empathy and put the body in front. And I must say that that was something that was done as well and transmitted through John's technique also of directing. I mean, he runs a show that he puts his body every day there, you know? He puts himself in front of the camera, he moves the things around. And it was the same kind of dynamic in a way when we were shooting the movie. He's a director unlike many, 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 many directors that shy themselves away from the camera, that, you know, that kind of become spectators of what's happening. John would put himself in front and you know, put the body in front. I mean, a bit like Herzog does, you know? I mean, he would put himself right there and that was inspiring for all of us to create that atmosphere and to create that kind of a notion of where we were at. And also, there were the inevitable things. I mean, we shot in a prison with real, what are they called, prisoners? Yeah, real prisoners. And we would have to go through the aisles where they are in solitary confinement, and they would be looking at us from the windows and talking to us, and we would be waiting there, and they would be, we would be very close with someone that the guards would say, oh, he's a rapist, he's this. I mean, that creates an atmosphere altogether. That creates something, and it's just unbelievable that when we were there was a point where we shot in one of the solitary cells. Like, right. I mean, just the feeling when the door closes. I mean, it's just terrible, terrible. I mean, it's you really feel like you're completely alone in the world, and that's how it's gonna be, and that nobody really ever cared for you in a way.
Was this your idea in shooting at right. the prison, or was it?
I mean, that was the idea, is to create that sense of their goal is to, you know, there's a line in the film, you can't just take his blood, you must take his hope. Their idea is to make you feel as though you are alone. And I think the best way to think about it is, think about your own lives and how much interaction means at the most basic level. The way that you catalyze frustration, the way that you catalyze anger, the way that you catalyze love, you know, no matter what your life is, it's all about interaction. I used to work in restaurants, you know, and you'd go in the morning and that your fucking manager would sit two people at a four top. What are you doing? That's insane. And then you would go back and there'd be four people by the salsa table and you'd be like, can you fucking believe this? Remove all of that. And now it's not a guy sitting two people at a four top. It's a guy telling you you'll never see your wife and child again. You're going to die and nobody cares about you. And you have nowhere to place that. You have no interaction. You have no ability to mitigate that fear, frustration, anger, contempt, disdain. You have nowhere to place it. And you have to internalize all of it. And so what I would do with Gael, because I don't believe in creating, to shoot a film like that, I don't think you have to create an atmosphere like that. We're making a movie, and it's very important to make a distinction. There's no courage in making a movie. There's courage in going through it, but making the movie should not feel like we're recreating those circumstances. But what I would do with Gael is, we would shoot the scenes in the solitary cell with the avatars of Maziar's father or his sister, and then we would shoot them without. And so he would complete the same scenes with an individual and without, and with and without. And we sort of move back and forth between those. And I think that's what's able to create that sense of slowly beginning to externalize the emptiness. And in that regard, I think it was helpful in a way to dramatize it.
And I think, in a sense, the film and the book, they are celebration of what is really important in life, that is family, culture, and art, and what the governments are trying to take away from people and replace it with things that are quite not important, like ideology, power, or religion. And I think what Gael does beautifully in the film is that he shows, and what Kim Bodnia, who plays the interrogator, does beautifully, is that they're showing two different opposites. That Kim shows someone who is really hollow, who believes blindly in an ideology, in a religion, and he thinks that he's going to torture this person, then he's going to die, and then he's going to paradise and have sex with 72 virgins or whatever. And Gael, what he does is that he's showing someone who is cultured, who has love for his family, who's listened to music, who's read books, who's seen movies, and he can protect that integrity by resorting to those experiences, even though you may not have it accessible to you within the solitary confinement, you still have that inherent inside you.
It's really a profoundly optimistic movie, which is remarkable when you think, you know, if you're walking on the street and someone says, what should I see here? You say, Rosewater, oh, what's that? Well, it's this movie about this Iranian prisoner in solitary confinement. The first thought you have is not, oh man, that's a real uplifting thing. I'm gonna go see it right now. But in fact, it is a profoundly optimistic work. And I think of a couple of scenes, Gael Maziar reaching toward the light in the prison courtyard with a blindfold on his face, which is just extraordinary image. And of course, the dancing as well, which is just remarkable. And I wanted to ask you about that scene, about how it came about, whether that was something that you had planned or you thought of it on the set or...
As a genius, I am able to control the sun. I can tell you exactly what happened in both of those scenes, and both of them were enormous screw-ups on my part. Saved by the brilliance. The scene of Gael in the courtyard, the solitary in the prison that we were at in Jordan opens up on, you know, a very small courtyard. And it's interesting, there's a larger courtyard with a football field where the prisoners can play, and we have a quick scene in that. But they've created another courtyard for people in solitary, and it's a solitary courtyard. It has the metrics of an outdoor space tailored to the idea of isolation. So you're outside, but you're still incredibly confined, and the walls are much higher than the width and length of the space, and there's barbed wire. And when we went to scout, I went with Bobby, who was the DP, and we were there. As we were scouting, I was watching the light move up. And as I was watching the light move up is when the scene came. Of it was not in the script, it was honestly just based on that scout of watching it move up. The difficult part was convincing the prison that we really had to be out there at 3 p.m. Honestly, you have to trust us. And for them, it was in the middle of Ramadan, so they had the iftar they had to make preparations for. So we basically had...
Iftar being the evening meal.
The evening meal after...
Breaking fast.
Breaking fast after each Ramadan. The Muslims, they fast for 30 days. Jews, we do it for one day because, really, we like to shop for the best bargain in terms of fasting.
I want to talk now about the Jewish-Iranian conspiracy.
Yes, exactly. That's right. So in that scene, we basically, we had 30 minutes, and it was just Gael, Bobby and I, as the sun went up, and Gael had to place himself in these various positions. But more importantly was the dancing scene, which at the end of a 14-hour day in 100-degree weather in this difficult condition, I knew that we had one more thing to do, so I said, Gael, by the way, could you stand in this room and let me just turn on this Leonard Cohen song, and could you dance? And he delivers, I think, one of the most spectacular and sublime and moving sequences that I've seen. And it's just the nuance of it. I mean, honestly, even while I was there that day watching it, I did not have as good a sense of just the intricacies and nuance of what he delivered. And being able to watch it again and again in the edit room it you know, I would constantly call him and go, "You're really good at this."
Do you want to tell us a little bit about the dancing?
I mean,
can you do it for us?
Exactly, guys.
Go ahead, please feel free.
Only. It doesn't work like that. It doesn't work like that. It's like, no, I mean, it's it is wonderful when there's a moment in a film, because this was, I guess, like halfway through the shooting, or perhaps a little bit, no, near the end, no?
Closer. I think we were about halfway.
Yeah, something.
We shot the movie backwards, just because I thought, wouldn't that be funny?
And so by that point, when in certain films, you all of a sudden, you're in that point of, yeah, on that point of no return. In a way, you're doing something that you have no idea if it's going to be, I mean, you have certainties at the moment, and you have impulses, and you have, okay, maybe, this is a better idea than this other one, blah, blah, blah. But at the end of the day, it's all, let's see how it comes out. Like, there's no, you're just jumping off a cliff. And there comes a moment with a certain ownership of a character where you can just say, like, okay, let's improvise a scene where you, make a reservation at a hotel and you stay there for like 3 nights and you can come up with any circumstance or any situation, and you can improvise it with the character, with the ownership of the characters, no? And that happens, unfortunately, that happens once you already started the film. I mean, like the first week, you still don't feel, the rapport prepared in a way to do that. So in a way, it felt, I think we all understood in a way what the cathartic notion of dancing in the cell was. I mean, we understood it rationally, emotionally, but then again, it's like jumping into cold water, no, or I don't know. I can relate it only to a scene in, like I did in Y Tu Mamá También, where I had to kiss my best friend and like make out with him for a long, long time. And there comes a point where it's like, okay, breathe in and let's just go for it. Let's just go for it. It's like, and let's just go for it. So it is like a solo dance experience, but it is, I love dancing. I mean, I love dancing a lot, and I always feel I will take in, I will get my passport taken out of me if I don't dance well, salsa, you know, and so I have that pressure on me, you know, and I love it. I love the catharsis of dancing, and I think that secretly, never openly, but secretly, there was a point in my life when I was like 13, 14, that I thought, maybe I should be a dancer. No. You know, like, but there was a little like a glimpse, because I really love it. I really love dancing.
That scene, I just want to ask all of you, it's obviously a crucial scene in the film, kind of hinge on which the film turns. And did you understand it as the character, as Maziar, realizing that he was going to get out, that he was going to survive this? Or was it a realization that this experience could not defeat him, could not beat him, no matter what happened to him?
Well, I'm trying to think as well, like, there might have been other resources to show or to make a cinematic notion of that transition. But, I mean, what's great about cinema in that sense is that with another abstract element, which is dance, you can't transmit that without having to, you know, have a eureka moment of like, this is it, I'm gonna go for, you know, like it doesn't become explicit, and it kind of serpents its way into what is happening, but in a much more, I don't know, much more joyful, kind of elegant, heartfelt way. I mean, you know, like wanna live, no? And so, yeah, let's dance. I mean
did you see, maybe I'd ask the same question to both of you, in where is the joy coming from? I mean, it feels very much like a universal scene about humanity, about a reaffirmation of humanity.
I mean, for me, it that was my, you know, that's my Footloose moment in the film. That's everybody cut loose. You know, the film is constructed in some ways as kind of a reclamation of humanity in the smallest of moments. sort of at the, you know, and I've used this analogy before, but at the bottom of the ocean, at the deepest sea, there's life. And you sometimes don't imagine it. And I think for humans, in our darkest moments, we still retain those things that make us uniquely human. And for me, dance and humor are those elements. And they are anachronistic in solitary confinement. And so for Maziar to reclaim his humanity, he reclaims it through humor and dance. He doesn't reclaim it through confrontation. Animals confront each other all the time, but what makes us uniquely human is the ability to express ourselves in these sort of almost ridiculous ways. And so for me, it was about juxtaposing the most joyful, cathartic physicality with the most narrow confinement and allowing that. And as you see in the dance, he touches every wall. He moves to each wall and he claims it as his dance partner rather than his oppressor. And it takes him away from all of it. But it's still a point past where the character had reclaimed himself he reclaims his humanity before he realizes he's going to get out of the prison. It was a very important thing to make sure was in the script, that it wasn't his release that allowed him to reclaim who he was. He did that on his own inside this dark prison through the power of his freedom. And that was the 1-2 punch of that.
And Leonard Cohen was always there. I mean, I've always been a big Leonard Cohen fan, and he's very prominent in the book, of course. And you know, it's not as if that it was Michael Bolton in the real life, and then we replaced it with Leonard Cohen.
No, it was a choice you could have made, right?
It was Leonard Cohen, and it was one of those absurd moments as well. I remember, like, the first time I thought about Leonard Cohen was that the interrogator left the room and he insulted me. He threatened me something that, you know, you're going to be executed next week. And then I thought to myself, that's not the way to say goodbye, you know. And, you know, I was just like, you know, just humorously. And then I started to hum Leonard Cohen's, that's not the way to say goodbye, that's not the way to say goodbye. I'm sorry, I'm not a good singer. And so that scene that's in the film is basically the amalgamation of two or three different events that really happened. One was a dream that I had about another Leonard Cohen song, The Sisters of Mercy, and something that happens in the film as well, that one of my interrogators called me Mr. Hillary Clinton, and I was doing sit-ups because I didn't have anything to do in the prison, and I was doing like a lot of sit-ups. And that day, I remember I did maybe 300 sit-ups because I knew that the rest of the world, you know, they were thinking about me. And again, to another Leonard Cohen song.
Those were the conversations that Maziar and I would have about the film, where I would, you know, I would talk about, my original intention was to have Leonard Cohen come to Jordan and be playing Dance Me while he danced. For some reason, I couldn't get Leonard to leave his tour to fly to Jordan for one day to film in a prison. But those were the conversations that we would have, where Maziar would say, you know, I think Sisters of Mercy would be very nice. And I'd say, I don't know, I think Dance Me might be the way to go. And then we would go back and forth, and then we would, you know, what about a Van Halen song? I don't know.
It is a profoundly optimistic film, and not only the part of it that we're talking about now, but I'm thinking of the images during the election and after the election of hashtags of the imagery of people joining together to try to replace this regime. And I'm remembering this morning as I left the hotel room, CNN was really beating the drums for war.
What? That doesn't sound like that.
We're talking 13 years after 9/11 about you know, why President Obama, have we not yet bombed Syria? And there's a feeling, it seems to me, of circularity about the politics we're watching, that we're caught in this endless loop of violence, repression, hopeful revolutions and that then lead to repression again, as in Egypt, to some degree Libya, civil war in Syria. And yet you have this profoundly optimistic film, not only about human resilience, but about the powers of history, I think it's fair to say, at least in its implications. And I wanted to ask all three of you about that how is the film justified by the events that we see before us every day and that you cover every night as part of your job? How is it justified?
Well, I think the optimism in the film is not really imposed. It's something that I deeply believe in, and I don't, I'm not a naive person. I'm not an optimist by nature, but there are certain things that are happening in Iran that makes me believe in that Iran in the long term will have, and Iran in the Middle and the Middle East will have a better future in the, not maybe in our lifetime, but eventually. And the fact that people are becoming more educated, the fact that people are becoming more cultured, the fact that people are becoming more interested in what is going on with the rest of the world. And that's why you see groups like ISIS, the Taliban, they are resorting to these such violent actions, because these are like knee-jerk reactions. When in, 500 years or 1,000 years we look at now, we don't think about ISIS or Taliban that much. They will be like maybe, what do they say, pimples on history's ass, yeah, something like that. But as John would say,
yeah. That will
sorry, I learned my English by watching The Daily Show. So I couldn't say, can I have a cup of coffee, but I could say, pimple on history's ass, yeah. So, but you remember people like Nelson Mandela, Martin Luther King, Václav Havel, Lech Wałęsa, and these people who were optimists in the worst situations, like Dalai Lama. These people, they will be remembered. And I think optimism is the only choice. And again, it's not an optimism that's idealistic. It's optimism that's rooted in pragmatism and what is happening in the Middle East and Iran right now.
Yeah. And it's based in evidence. Maziar's story, what's so compelling about it is that each aspect of it is, its narrative is really interesting in terms of the cycle of his family, his father being imprisoned by the Shah, his sister being imprisoned by Khomeini, he being imprisoned by Khamenei. And you watch this cycle and you think, oh, an entire generation of a family lost to this kind of oppression. But at the base of the film, surrounding it, is the theme of the cost of oppression, not for those who are oppressed, but for the oppressors. And I think, the reason why it's an optimistic film is that I think we've learned through history, the burden to oppress is far greater than those that have to endure it. And we learn that through colonialism, and we learn that through other systems of government that use that type of pressure to control people. It is not sustainable. It has never been sustainable. The only thing that is sustainable is those individuals' desire to broaden their horizons, to connect with other people, to be human. That's what survives. And so ultimately, when I write, unfortunately, in the structure of a joke. And I always have. It's the first thing I learned how to do. And it's even within the narrative of a film. This film is an elaborate joke. And it's not a joke on Maziar, it's a joke on the oppressors. The entire film is a government spending billions of dollars using incredible resources, institutionalizing torture to keep information about itself from getting out. And you follow this journey from 90 minutes of this incredible burden on the oppressors to keep this information in. And the final shot is a 9-year-old boy going, oh, fuck it, I'll do it. And that's the joke. And the joke is on them. And that's why it's optimistic.
That 9-year-old is the future.
I think the adding to something also in the experience of shooting the film, what Maziar and John are saying, it's also it's this sort of pragmatic kind of optimism that you feel, you sense right there in the most mundane daily activities. I mean, and we can talk about all these impositions that are governmental or huge institutionalized impositions, like a wall saying like this is one country, this is the other. Here, Mexico, the United States. I mean, there is a huge wall that's there, and when you're there, and you're with some. I mean, the people that live right there in front of that imposition are the first ones to incorporate complete disconnection with that imposition, a complete like this doesn't exist. You know, like, and we have to, yes, we have to do this, and we have to do these bureaucratic things, but, you know, we're not gonna put this as the forefront and the main objective and the main thing that's in our lives, you know? We're gonna transcend that. And it is a way of survival, it is a way of, natural way of human empathy that everyone has in the world, and I think that's where when we were there in Jordan shooting, I mean, with Syria conflict happening in Egypt, it was beginning. It was right the beginning of this second part of the conflict, no? And we went to several refugee camps, which, I mean, right now there's 3 million people, refugees from Syria, causing, I mean, this is going to do a big toll in humanity. I mean, it is incredible what's going on. And you visit the families there, and you know, I mean, of course, in the mundane daily activities, well, there's still that optimism. But then, when you start to talk about the structure of things, when you start to talk about what's the main problem, is like, man, I have my kids that haven't been gone to school for like 5 years now, or 3 years, and that's a big problem, because if they don't go to school, then what would be worth fighting for in the future? I mean, if they don't, if we don't build a society, then these kids are not going to school. That is one of the biggest problems that the refugees have. And I mean, humanity is accountable for that. I mean, we're all responsible for that. But just showing the differences, because there is where you feel, okay, yes, we're fucked. No, there's no. Doesn't feel like there's any answer. But then when you're in the ground, when you're in the mundane, in the little activities of sharing a tea, of sharing someone's house, of exchanging something, exchanging a joke, then that's where you think, okay, well, no, there is a lot worth fighting for, and a lot of optimism to be that's coming.
Just to push back a little here, I mean, there is a difference between living in dignity with integrity under an authoritarian regime and actually causing that regime to change, actually removing it, supplanting it. We look at Iran and the authoritarian regime is still there, and indeed there's a history in this film going back to 1953 when the US in a CIA coup restored the Shah to power of autocracy. The Shah's autocracy of 25 years, now the Islamic Revolution of 35 years. And it strikes me in Maziar's book, and also by implication in the film, that there's a kind of skepticism about revolution itself. And we can perhaps have it ourselves, looking at the news over the last decade, you know, the Arab Spring, 2011, we now have a government in Egypt, which was the beginning of it, after Tunisia anyway, we have a government in Egypt that looks very much like the Mubarak regime, only to some degree worse. So I want to push back a little bit here and talk about, because it seems to me a very important question, about what is the mechanism for actual, real change? I mean, you had details of this in the movie, an election that was about to be stolen, right. People coming together through Facebook, through Twitter, and so on, and yet it didn't in the end work. Or am I wrong to say that?
I think that you can look at it on a different continuums, and you can say something worked or something didn't work. Within the context of the 2009 Green Revolution, Mousavi is still under house arrest. has that country open up, we have a vision of what an open country looks like that may not necessarily jibe with other countries and what they feel like is important to the integrity of their country. But I will say, without the bravery of the Greens in 2009, you don't get Rouhani. And you may say, well, is Rouhani better than Ahmadinejad? I don't think there's any question. It's not, nothing is perfect. But I think if you expect perfection, you will find yourselves disappointed. You know, there was a guy in 2008, and I can't remember where it was, who ran on, Hope and Change, I think, was his slogan. And
where was that?
I can't remember where it was. And there was a feeling that, oh, well, this one guy will bring hope and change, and we will now be a perfect society. But it doesn't work according to cinematic visions of. We have too clearly internalized dramatic structure and forgotten the lessons of kind of a macro view of history. The world is better now, not for everybody. It is a better world than it was 200 years ago. Islam is 1,400 years old. Christianity is, you know, 2,000 years old. The pitfalls and things that Christianity went through, the bloody wars, you know, that is a part of its history. And it evolved over that time. And through incremental change and these notions of people pushing it for more freedom and for more liberty. And it's a pendulum swing back and forth. But we've sort of talked about it before. The arc of the moral universe is long, but it bends towards justice. And I think that is the case. And as individuals within each, you know, it's sort of like, this is a ridiculous example. The stock market. Stock market in the 80s, man, it went up. You got to put your money in the stock market. But then there's a crash. But what they say to you is, if you keep it in there for 50 years, you're going to do great, which is wonderful. But if you're the asshole in 1987 who just retired and the whole thing crashed, it seems awfully bleak and awfully dark. And you can look at it within those terms, or you can stand back. And within that, I would say that what has happened in Egypt and what has happened in Tunisia and what has happened in Iran is absolutely crucial to the long-term prospects of the evolution of that part of the world. And I think you see it in small moments. And it's not going to get better in the way that we want it to, in dramatic structure. But in real time, in epochal time, it does.
Maziar, well, yeah, I think it happens in a dramatic structure, but while we are in a film festival, I can use a film metaphor that it's not going to happen in a dramatic structure like Die Hard or Iron Man. It will be more like a Tarkovsky film or a Michael Haneke film. It's going to be very slow, but it's going to be more sustainable. Again, I guess in 1,000 years, when people look at the cinema right now, they don't remember Iron Man or Die Hard that much, but Tarkovsky.
Don't say that. Yeah.
Tarkovsky or Michael Haneke will be remembered. And it's specifically in terms of Iran, or we were actually talking to Gael about other countries who've gone through upheavals recently, like Bosnia, where he was. Countries that go through real violent upheaval, they look at sudden changes with trepidation. When I was watching I've been watching the Syrian revolution unfolding for the past 2 years, and when I see people who are killing, who are dying for a cause, it really scares me. Because that happened in Iran. When someone is willing to be martyred for a cause, that person, when he comes to power, and usually it's a he, it's always a he actually, he comes to power, he doesn't think twice about killing others to stay in power. And that's what really makes me optimistic about the situation in Iran, because most young people in Iran do not believe in any ideology, any religion, anything that's worth dying for. They respect life, they respect culture, they respect art, they respect each other, and they're not willing to die. And I think the film shows that as well. And the Green Movement, and I always have this conversation with news editors that they say, well, let's do something about the Green Revolution. And I always say, well, it was not really a revolution. People did not come to the streets saying, death to the Islamic Republic, death to Khamenei. We want to bring a Scandinavian-style government to power. It was just a movement to ask for the votes to be recounted. And people thought that would be a step forward. And I think the Green Movement has somehow succeeded, as John said, and it will. We will see, I mean, we may not see the manifestations of the Green Movement and people's desire to change in Iran right now, but it is going on and it's being deepened at the moment.
It could be said in very short terms that in the next election, the votes were counted. Rouhani
exactly.
was not the choice.
Yeah, and
of
the government,
theocratic
yeah,
rulers.
It was. He was the least liked candidate of the conservatives, and people voted for him because of that, not because Rouhani is someone special, but he was the best of the bad choices that people had.
Why do you think they let the votes be counted this time? I mean, this is just more specific.
Well, the thing is that, I mean, what happened in 2009 was that the Revolutionary Guards and Ayatollah Khamenei, they've contested, and documents have been released and speeches have been revealed that they were really afraid of Mousavi coming to power, a reformist coming to power, and they thought that, you know, the power of the supreme leader would be undermined, the power of the Revolutionary Guards would be undermined, Iran would have normal relations with the rest of the world. And you have to understand that this is not an ideological war. The Revolutionary Guards are the biggest industrialists in the country. They have many economic interests in chaos and constant conflict and constant conflict with the rest of the world. So they thought, you know, they can take over the power, they could arrest people like me, and, you know, I was arrested with the same arrest warrant that was used for 500 other people. Same, it was basically a Xerox arrest warrant with no name on it. It was something like that. And then it backfired, and, you know, the country became, you know, the power of the supreme leader and his legitimacy was undermined even more. So they thought, you know, in order to preserve a certain legitimacy of the system, in order for their own survival, not because of the goodness of their heart, they had to allow people to vote again and count their votes.
I have to ask you about a scene in the book that was rather frightening and moving, which is that people may not know, you actually met with Rosewater after you were released.
Oh, yeah.
From prison. And, you know, reading that, you think, what the hell was it like to meet in a restaurant or a cafe? It was a public place with someone who had basically beaten the hell out of you and had this rather intimate, insane relationship, imposed relationship with you over 118 days. And I'm wondering what that was like and whether you were tempted to put it in the film.
Yeah, it was one of those weird moments that it was somehow humorous as well. Because he and his boss, who is also in the film, we called him Hajaga, they invited me to a cafe in order to threaten me just the night before my flight back to London. And we were in this cafe, and they ordered some cake, so the cakes arrived, and Rosewater asked the waiter, where is our tea? And the waiter said that, excuse me, it's going to take about 10 minutes for the water to boil. And he just gave the most vicious look at the waiter and he said, I want my tea now. And within like 1 minute, we had like three teas at the table. And then after having the tea and cake, he told me that you're not going to tell anyone what happened in prison. You're not going to do any interviews. You're not going to write about this. Otherwise, we are going to bring you back in a bag. So as he was saying that, I was taking mental notes, and then I was just like, hey, no, Santa, I have to write this. And of course. Of course, I guess 10 days later or something, I had a Newsweek cover story, and I was on The Daily Show.
Were you at all tempted to put, I mean, it obviously falls outside the frame of the film. On the other hand, the scene itself is rather terrifying and fraught with a lot of implications. These people outside of prison, right, in the larger world.
Yeah, there were, actually, there were elements of that that were shot once he came out. But, you know, one of the things I tried to maintain once we got to a certain point, and this was when I first got back from Jordan, I had my editor, Jay Rabinowitz, who was back in New York the whole time, I call him the maestro. He's phenomenal and a beautiful man. And so he had compiled the rough assemblage. And again, I'm a first-time director, so I didn't know what that meant other than, oh, good, he put together the movie I made, and now I can come watch it, and then I guess we'll just, I don't know, put it out. And I watched it, and it was 3.5 hours long, and it was a giant pile of shit. And so there was an awful lot that of what I thought in terms of the script were quite clever, quite intellectual, but that got in the way of the emotional narrative. And so there were scenes like that with Rosewater and Hajaga and Maziar at the end. I'll bring you back in a bag and all that, but it felt more clever than real. And there was even we shot a scene on the plane as he was coming home where if you're on a plane in the Middle East and you're flying towards London or wherever, oftentimes they'll serve you rosewater. It's called white tea. And they'll come by with the cart and it's boiling and you can smell the rosewater. And so there's a scene of when Maziar has first been released and he's on the plane and suddenly the scent of his interrogator is in the plane with him as he just got out. And it's terrifying and it sounds a lot better than... But when you watched it, it worked on an intellectual level, but it took you out of the emotional narrative. And so a lot of that, those were just some of the decisions, I guess, that everybody has to make in those situations.
You know, I have to ask one question about the title of the book, Then They Came For Me, which is the implication of it. This comes from a rather famous quote from Pastor Niemöller that, you know, they came for the socialists, I wasn't a socialist, so I didn't speak out. Then they came for the Jews, I wasn't a Jew, I didn't speak out. Then they came for me, there was no one to speak out. And there is a kind of implication of guilt in the title that, you know, that you should have known more or should have done more before you were arrested. And that is played out a little bit. We talked about this the other night in the film, in the moment of decision where you didn't want to tape the satellite discs because you believed there was a line that you couldn't cross. And then there was that key moment when you actually did raise the camera and film the shooting at the Basij headquarters and the amazing shot of that one man being shot. Could you talk about that just for a moment, the title and whether there was a kind of change in you?
To tell you the truth, we were not thinking about that poem, Then They Came For Me, but of course, there is that context, but you always live with a level of guilt that what can you do? And you know, all journalists do. I mean, that guy was being shot in front of me. What could I have done? Could I just protect him, or could I just continue shooting? It's always that guilt, but the title really, I don't think that, It's not in the context of that story, that poem, the Holocaust poem. It is about my family's story, and it doesn't really reflect that guilt. But the guilt, you're right, is there because I think all journalists, but especially journalists who work in conflict situations, they live with. And, you know, in Iran, it was not really a conflict situation except for that day, but I had worked in Iraq and, you know, there were bombings, people were being carried out, and I always wondering whether I should just put down the camera and help them or not. It's a guilt that you always have to live with as a journalist.
But I think it also has to do with, my interpretation after reading the book is that it is also about, the title is about the cycles of history you were talking about. I mean, showing it on a family structure, how it just recurred and the quite crazy, humoristic, but also sad contradiction of Maziar's father being tortured by the Shah, as well as Rosewater's father being tortured by the Shah. How did it come about? How did we get here? You know, how did we, how, why is this happening? And now it's me. I mean, that me is, it's now, you thought that you were escaping the cycle of history in a way. I mean, in this kind of, young kind of potential freedom that we all want to access when we're growing up and everything. And all of a sudden it's like, wait a minute, it's still, there is this, I'm not saying that there's a, we're condemned to repeat that little cycle, those cycles, but then there is a picture that you can say, oh my God, it's coming. And I mean, and my interpretation also, when Maziar realized that maybe there was hope that maybe Mousavi could win, there was a glimpse. I mean, because Maziar was very, still very, separated from it and thinking, this is all the same shit. It's never going to go well. This is not going to happen. I mean, like, but then there was a glimpse. And in the book, you're saying it, especially when you go hiking, no? Yeah. That you think, well, maybe this is the time. And then we enter that kind of like, we're also part of that cycle at that point, because these cycles of like, maybe this is the time when things will change, actually. Well, and you fall earnestly into that, no?
I mean, Marx says that history repeats itself once as a tragedy and the second time as a comedy. So I think it was like that. And maybe in a way that we are making that poem and, that Holocaust poem on its head, that it was history being repeated, but in a more comical way and in a more satirical way, that, that these authoritarian regimes never learn. They come after you, but it is, as John said, they are the ones who are losers at the end.
That it seems to me, is a profound dichotomy that cuts through the film. On the one hand, being trapped within the cycles of history. On the other, our responsibility to do what we can to try to alter it and to try to change it. And it seems to me, when you lift up the camera at that moment, you're making a conscious choice that you have a responsibility to do what you can to change history. And that really brings me to my last question to everyone on the stage, that all of you are involved in communicating with the public, trying to affect the public and trying to influence it, trying to move history in your own way. John, you made a decision to move from your daily perch at the Daily Show and to go into film, and this is your first film. And Gael, of course, you're involved in trying to influence the public every day in your work, and as Maziar is too. And you cannot, I should say, go back to Iran now. So what is...
I can go back, but I cannot come out.
Thank you for that correction. What is our responsibility to try to change history? What must we do? Let me start with Gael.
Yeah, well, I mean, obviously, placing that responsibility on cinema is quite a huge, huge load, and maybe it corrupts the genesis of any art form, really, because it's a you can't work like doing commercials in a way like, I want this to be sold, this product to be sold a lot, so let's make a good commercial for this. You can't, I mean, like, art forms or things that entertainment that has an artful consequence do not work in that formula. No, I mean, it's more the questions that are open, the unexpected tangents that are transited and opened, and who knows where the films will take you. I mean, who knows what that film is going to mean for anybody? I mean, all of a sudden there is a beautiful alchemy that is formed when a good film comes out, and the first clear thing that needs to happen is that the film is good. I mean, a bad film cannot change things. A good film, even if it's about two people in the room, can talk about the big issues and can like really transcend into another sphere. But putting it into a much more pragmatic way, I mean, what my approach to cinema is, I mean, I don't try to rationalize it too much in my involvement in films as an actor or as a director, like I don't, or as a producer even. I don't try to place that weight and really mostly enjoy the craftsmanship of making a film, but as a taking a step back, I mean, we have this organization called Ambulante, which is a documentary film festival that that's been now 10 years. It's in its 10th edition next year. And it's a documentary film festival that travels around Mexico for in 16 cities. And it's going to be in Colombia now as well, and in California as well. They invited us to be there.
Yeah.
So it is a wonderful, I mean, I'm really proud of it because it is a wonderful group of people that have done it. Some of them have been all the way throughout, especially the director, Elena Fortes. She's been like from the beginning till now. And we get, you know, close to 100,000 people looking at documentaries every year in this festival that travels. And before we used to have this situation where you would, I mean, a documentary would be shot in Ciudad Juarez and then it would only be shown in Rotterdam. And people from Ciudad Juarez could not see it. But now this is the objective of this documentary film festival. It travels and it brings the films where they were shot in public plazas, in cinemas, blah, 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 blah. All of this I'm saying because this is what I can do in practical terms is this, to think, okay, we're helping to build a film culture, documentaries that we enjoy. I enjoy watching all of them and sharing this and being able to be part of this questioning. I mean, it's to discover, to share, and to transform. That's the dilemma, the motto of our film festival. And I invite you all to look at the webpage. It's www.ambulante, like ambulant, you know, like ambulante.com.mx. Try it out. Thank you.
Maziar.
I think people have to be individuals. I think people have to learn, doubt, and love. I think that these are the most important things that can change history, because if as individuals you don't believe in any absolute truth, that you always doubt something, but at the same time you love what is really important to you, your family, your friends, your environment, this is how you can change it. But of course, as Gael pitched his organization, I'm going to tell you about the fact that since I've come out, I've started a project called iranwire.com, and it's in English and Persian, and the basic idea is to piss off the Iranian government by putting the young Iranian in touch with the rest of the world. So, for example, we put young Iranians in touch with Burmese, with Greeks, Serbian, American citizen journalists. And it's not all about politics and overthrowing the regime. It's about learning how to communicate, how to gather information and disseminate information.
John, do you have a TV show you want to pitch?
I have a website. It's Jewish dating site. It's, you know, in activism is very personal to people. And I think with work, what you can do is, and I have a great deal of respect for those who are activists on the ground, who have dedicated their lives to the day-to-day bringing of causes. But too often that creates its own dogma. And too often, the perspective of that, again, loses sight of empathy. And I think, look, I've never been a firm believer that satire is a great way for bringing about world change. You know, Peter Cook, the great satirist in Britain, he was asked once, what was the greatest satire of all times? And he was just kind of flummoxed, and the reporter said, because I believe it is in Germany, in 1936, it was the Follies of Berlin was the greatest satire. And Peter Cook said, yeah, they really showed Hitler. That being said, so much of art is just to bring a sense to those that view it that they're not alone. Because the power of two is not arithmetic, but it's logarithmic. And once you feel like your experience that you go through, that your burden on a day-to-day basis is not solitary, but in fact shared experience, that goes a long way towards bringing strength. And I've always felt like I've always been a believer in the quiet activism of living pleasantly. And that is that understanding that you don't understand the burden of all those around you, so that when you go to a restaurant and you order tea, and it is, and this really is, you know, it's understanding that maybe it's gonna take 10 minutes, and that's okay. Because you don't know their burden and they don't know yours, and the quiet activism of living pleasantly means you're not adding any weight to their burden. And as you go through that, that in and of itself, I think, is somewhat heroic. And so that's where I would leave.
Ladies and gentlemen, leaving it on the note of, on the quiet, say it again.
The quiet activism of living pleasantly. How about that?
We'll all take that into our day. Please join me in thanking our guests.